We are here for a candid conversation with Mr. Sandeep Vasligar, and he needs no introduction, I feel. But still, I will just give a short introduction of Mr. Vasligar. He's a global influencer, and he's known for that he's a global influencer. And he's author of three books, out of which one book, which is there, that is a very famous book. And I was told he has been interviewed by more than 2,000 magazines, newspapers, televisions across 70 to 80 countries. And he brings with him a wealth of knowledge, wealth of wisdom on many aspects of life, right? From politics to governance to business to entrepreneurship. And very excited to have him here again with us in CF, because humne inko last year we had invited him. We had the privilege to listen to him last year. And we had such an awesome time, invite him on board. But I would like to share that jo sir ne last time baat kari thi, mujhe yaad hai, wo abhi tak zehen mein hai. Sir, jo aapne last time you had spoken to us, you had spoken about, the three kinds of entrepreneurs who were there. And then the ones which are, the first one you had spoken about, ek Japanese hotel hai, which is around 700 years old. You had spoken about that hotel. And people still know that story, that ek usre ka entrepreneur hai. And then you had spoken about a Chinese guy who just changed his business into nanotechnology, and then he became a billionaire. And then you had also spoken about the first kind of entrepreneur, three kinds of entrepreneurs you had spoken about. So, itna logon ko abhi bhi dhyan mein hai ke aapne kya bola tha, and you had spoken to all of us that you got to be keeping a vision of being in the top five in the world, in your area. And that's what your aim should be. Aap bano nahi bano, but that's the vision which you should have in your mind. So, it was so impactful. And I'm sure this very evening also would be equally impactful for all of us. So, would like to throw the entire forum open with you now taking over. Sir, abhi ye jo ho raha hai, corona, we have been through all this, entrepreneurs are going through what they're going. So, the major question in their mind is, now what next? So, when we say what next, in all aspects of whether it be global scenario, whether it be the national scenario, the entrepreneurship scenario, in general, lives jo hain logon ki uthal-putal ho gayi hain for the last 1.5 months. And still there's so much of uncertainty there. We still don't know, lockdown open ho raha hai, nahi ho raha hai. Will this be controlled? Will there be a cure? Will there be a vaccine? Hai to kab aayegi? Kaun laayega? So a lot of uncertainty is there. So what next? So as entrepreneurs, they have a lot of questions in mind ki hum kya karein, kya sochein, kya pakdein. At the same time, personally, they are also shaken up. So I invite you on board with this question, what next, sir? So what are your views and insights on what next?
Anish, what next really depends on how long this crisis will go on. Huh. There are now various possibilities. Today only there is a good news for the world, not for us, but for the world, that New Zealand has emerged as the first country without any coronavirus. They have managed to eliminate the disease. This is the latest development. And interestingly, New Zealand has managed to do it without a big lockdown. They had lockdown, but very limited lockdown. In fact, I have a friend who used to be a member of parliament and a senior ambassador of New Zealand. And he told me that in their kind of lockdown, they were allowed to go on the beach, but not allowed to swim. So he was complaining, my prime minister is not allowing me to swim. But we can walk on the beach and we can walk anywhere. So with this kind of lockdown, they managed to eliminate the disease from the entire country, and they have just emerged today as the... So for humanity, it is a good news. So now that relates to the basic question you are asking, what next? Because it depends on how long this disease will go on, how long this pandemic will go on for different countries. And of course, our concern is for India. There are various possibilities. Maybe if we get encouraged by what has happened in New Zealand, what is happening in South Korea, even Taiwan to some extent, even to a certain extent China, we can hope that this will come in control in a couple of months' time all over the world, including US, including India, including Europe. So let's say by June or so by end of June. Now, if that happens, then slowly, I think about a year or two, there will be a lot of disturbances. There will be a lot of economic and business and supply chain, particularly supply chain disruptions. But I think in about a year and a half, things will slowly go back to normal. Now, some things might change, but a lot of things will slowly go back to normal, if that is what happens. But if New Zealand and South Korea turn out to be exception, and if the problem goes on for several months until the vaccine is out in the market and people are able to use it, then I just don't know. Because if the problem goes on beyond summer, into the winter and into next year, or if it relapses again, and then if the number of deaths really increase, because right now it's 200,000 globally. So if it is up to 250,000, 300,000, they're going to reach anyway in the next 2 months. But if it goes really beyond that, then it's really difficult to predict. So that is one aspect as to how long the pandemic will go on. And at this stage, I would say, since I'm not a medical expert, I simply would say I don't know. I'm inspired by New Zealand, but we have to wait and see what happens. The second issue is the economic, social, and psychological impact of pandemic. And the lockdown that has been associated with around the world. Economic setbacks, you know, entrepreneurs know what kind of difficulties you are experiencing. Supply chains will get curtailed. There are some major difficulties. For example, currently the total number of aircrafts in the world are about 28,000. And of all the airlines together, there are 800 airlines and 28,000 aircrafts. So they had placed orders for another 5 to 7,000 aircrafts in the next couple of years. And now the reports from Boeing and Airbus are suggesting that the airline companies are withdrawing those orders and they are not wanting to place. So suddenly, 7,000-8,000 aircrafts which were going to be manufactured in the next couple of years are not going to be produced. So you can imagine the consequences not only for the two big companies, but also for their ancillary industries and for their employees and for the consumer market that the employees were harnessing. And similarly, in other sectors, container industries, the shipping container industry will be also equally affected. So all of this will have impact on employment. All of this will have impact on social stability. And there could be a big risk that there could be social discontent next year in 2021. On the top of that, if the food supply is affected, and if people don't get food, now the World Food Program has already announced that there is a risk of a famine in some parts of the world, not because of lack of production, but because of the lack of dissemination, lack of distribution, because of the disruption in the food supply. Now, if the airlines are not going to fly, even the cargo airlines, and if the shipping business is going to be reduced, then of course there will be disruptions in food supply. Now, for India, it is okay because we have almost 75 million tons of surplus food grains. And about a quarter of them are anyway being eaten by rats and pests. As long as we can just move from godown to the people, we will be able to manage it. And I think we have a fairly good system. So I don't think we will have any famine or any problem like that, even assuming bad rains in the coming summer. I mean, there is no reason to assume that. But even if by chance, if we don't have good rain, even then this year we'll be able to manage with the surplus food grains we have. But all over the world, they don't necessarily have the home-produced food grains. They depend on the international market. And if they are not able to procure their supplies from the international market, then the prices are going to go up. And the prices will the high prices will affect everybody. Whether you are living in Latin America, whether you are living in Southern Europe, whether you're living in Africa, everybody will be affected. So how would all of this translate into social tensions? That is the question. If there is a big social discontent next year, and then it depends on the political leadership. As you only said once, that the leaders, whether they're in business or whether they're in politics, they have to lead, they don't have to manage. And that is something that would be tested next year. Whether the politicians would be able to lead a way out of this, because they won't be able to manage the social discontent. So what kind of impact would it have? That would then have a cyclical impact on the economic activities. So it's just the coronavirus itself, it's all these other factors. I'll summarize in one sentence that basically coronavirus, if it comes into control in the next couple of months, in 2 years' time, things will go back to normal. But it will depend on how the politicians are able to manage social discontent, which is likely to take place next year in 2021, which will be result of the economic dislocations.
Okay. So, sir, with this as a background, now, what do you think? We are talking about the small and medium scale entrepreneurs who are there with us, and so they have two things. One is for them as to what they should keep in mind. Should they strategize for maybe, you know, diversification? Should they look out for new things which will emerge, or should they hold on to what they're already doing? Right. That's one thing which is on their mind. So, what kind of strategizing they should do?
Well, I think first of all, before we discuss the question, what kind of strategizing, I think it's important that they should strategize. They should think of strategizing. That is most important. I'll give you an example. This coronavirus, a lot of people are, and media is projecting it as a surprise. But it is not as big a surprise as it is made out to be. On the 30th of January, the WHO announced it as a global health emergency. So this was already announced on 30th of January. And in most countries in the world, absolutely no step was taken in the entire month of February and even the beginning of March. Now, one aspect is political. So we will keep that out, that the politicians should have consulted each other from different parts of the world and coordinated with each other as to what kind of steps they should take. But the businessmen were simply not aware. They were not following the news. So if they knew that there is a health emergency, global health emergency announced, actually speaking, on the 31st of January, all the business organizations should have been talking to each other to find out what to do and what could be the possible consequences and what is that we need to do. You have been caught with a surprise because you didn't follow the whole big word news that was announced on the 30th of January. So that is why businesses are not strategizing. They are just busy. A lot of the entrepreneurs spending time on social media. They just go by what appears in WhatsApp. They are not following the serious news and serious developments. Now, in October of last year, there was something called Event 201. Now, this took place at the Johns Hopkins University, and it was sponsored by Bill Gates. When they did an exercise on if, and the world's leading business executives, representatives of big business companies were present here. Now, they discussed that if a pandemic takes place, a big pandemic takes place, what would be the consequences? And they talked about how supply chains would be disrupted, how flights will be stopped, how the shipping business would be affected. They talked about all this in detail. This report, I got it within a couple of days' time and not from any secret source. I mean, it was a public document. I don't think many people were looking at this report. This happened in October. So in October, there was an announcement made by a major process led by Bill Gates about what would be the consequences in case of pandemics. And then on the 30th of January, you actually had an announcement by the WHO that there is a global health emergency. And I didn't, at least you are more close to business and you tell me if I'm wrong. I mean, I will be happy to be corrected. Was there any big discussion from 31st January or 1st December that the WHO has announced a global health emergency? What would it mean for business? How would it affect the supply chains? How would it affect ancillary industries? It will lead to lockdown. What should we do? What are the steps we should take now before the lockdown is announced? Was there any discussion on 1st of February? Was there any discussion on 2nd February in a big way? As I don't know. If you know, maybe you know better. So
even governments were sleeping.
The governments were sleeping. The industries were sleeping. Governments were not sleeping. They were busy fighting with each other. Not our government, but the two big governments in the world, the US and China. I mean, they were just fighting with each other instead of trying to coordinate. And I mean, 30th of January, this announcement was made by WHO. On 14th of February, just 2 weeks after that, the foreign ministers of all the countries in the world were together in Munich. So they could have sorted out all the problems right there. And they could have worked out coordination. They were together. They didn't have to call a meeting. They were already together on 13th and 14th February for 2 days in Munich. So even the Chinese foreign minister was there, US Secretary of State was there, our foreign minister was there, everybody was there. And so they could have discussed that, you know, WHO had announced emergency 2 weeks ago at that time. And this is what is going to happen. What should we do? How do we cooperate with each other? How do we coordinate with each other? Now, I don't know whether this was discussed. There was no alert given to businessmen, but businessmen are also not reading and finding out what is happening. I mean, it's not that you always have to follow the government. Sometimes you can be one step ahead of the government also. So I would say to the first part of your question is what kind of strategizing they should do. I think first of all, now at least they should open their eyes and understand the importance of strategizing and looking ahead. This is what I also mentioned to you when we met last in much happier circumstances, that they are not willing to look ahead. They must look ahead. If they had looked ahead, they would have planned all the steps for this lockdown, their markets, their staff, their labor, everything at the beginning of March, much before the government of India announced the lockdown. That would have been okay. See, I have been okay. I have had not been affected by this lockdown at all. Because in February, I cleared all the salaries for 2 months in advance to all my staff. So nobody is having a problem now. If this goes to June, I could have a problem. But at least 2-3 months salaries I cleared. I did all the paperwork that was required. Everything I did as soon as I saw the problems coming in. So every businessman should have done this. That this is where the problem was coming. But they should have followed what is happening. Anyway, so first thing, at least in future, they should really try to see what is going on. They should invest their resources in it. They should invest their energy in it. You know, a lot of the businessmen think that these are all soft aspects of business. They don't want to spend on it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they don't want to spend. They want to spend on production. They want to spend, they don't even want to spend a lot on marketing, but they want to spend a little bit on marketing. But, you know, businessmen don't want to spend on building their knowledge, building their overall vision, which is what is going to take them miles ahead. Everything else is going to take them inches ahead. And here, if they get wrong, they're going to fall down also by miles. And this is what has happened to the entire industry now. Because they did not see a news which was out in the public domain, I repeat, which was out in the public domain, every businessman is having a problem today. This is the reason. Because they did not take it seriously. Because they don't want to invest in getting this kind of information. They don't want to invest in developing skills to develop their knowledge. So that is one. The second aspect, I think, which will be very important for companies that have, you know, good number of staff now, which will be very, very important, is that we are going to have anxiety epidemic. Like we have the corona epidemic, soon we will have anxiety epidemic. Anxiety means a lot of people will start feeling mentally disturbed. A lot of people will start feeling distressed. And the companies will have to think that this is very important part of their holistic management. And how to manage this anxiety epidemic that will come in order to make their staff productive once the lockdowns are lifted and companies slowly start working. So they have to look at the mental health. This is something that our companies don't even think about the mental health. But they will have to think under the current circumstances. Next 1 year, 1.5 year is going to be very challenging for mental health of the employees. So they will have to think of that. I mean, if you are only going to think of production and marketing, and if you are not going to think of the mental health of your employees, it's going to create a lot of problems. Third, every difficulty creates its own opportunity. You know, while some of the businesses are closing, India is going to lead in the next 1 year in the vaccine business. So, because of coronavirus and because of, we don't know which other virus will set in future, people have realized now the importance of vaccines. And India has some companies which are capable of mass producing vaccine for the entire world's market. Here in Pune, there is one such company, Serum Institute. But there are also other companies. There is one in Hyderabad. There are other companies. And they are being approached by the world for mass production. because they can produce millions and billions of tons of billions of doses, which a lot of companies in Europe and America are not able to do. They simply don't have capacity in the West. So some of these Indian companies are already, some of them are multinationals, but they are going to be giants, and they'll be giants in a matter of 1 year. So some Indian companies which are really, really small scale will become multi billion dollar huge corporations in a matter of next 6 to 8 months because of their ability to produce vaccines on a mass scale. Now, I don't know how the vaccine business works, but whether there is a scope to do any ancillary work there, whether there is a scope to be any supplier there, whether there is the kind of a supply chain, not in their core business, not in the vaccine itself, but if they produce on such a large scale, they will also require employees, they will require a lot of other things. So it may be interesting to see how this whole growth of vaccine industry in India, which is definitely going to take place, and these some companies are going to become giants, if there is any scope in the periphery of those companies.
Right.
On the other hand, you have to know that some sectors are going to go down, like aviation sector is going to go down. International trade is going to be affected a little bit. Finally, after 1-2 years, it will come up. So basically, I would say if I were in business, I would do a mapping of where in the next 4-5 years, which sectors will come up and which sectors will suffer a damage. And I would then accordingly decide where to invest my resources. So that is what I would do looking ahead.
So taking this mapping side, sir, now with this pandemic, the entire economy has slowed down, come to a standstill as of now. So government will have to put in, and they are putting in stimulus. So consumption has to increase, and that's a simple way our understanding goes into reviving the economy. Now here, do you think some reshuffling of the budgets will happen? For example, a question has come in that will the government budgets be now more used for reviving the economy, and it will be taken away from the infrastructural budgets which were there. So do you foresee something of this happening?
As far as I can guess, I have not spoken to anybody in the government. I don't have first-hand information. But as far as I can guess, I think their first priority, and quite rightly, is how to save the country from this crisis. How to save the life. You know, the question of livelihood is something they will take up later. To some extent, they are looking at it, but their top priority is really how to save life. Because there is a whole uncertainty. New Zealand could escape it very fast. Also, New Zealand is a country with very small population, not even equal to one of the cities, big cities in India. So they could do it. But in a country like India, where there is a high density of population, how do we come out of it? So far, the numbers are encouraging. They are not as bad as the numbers in, say, Italy, Germany, France, some of the European countries, and definitely not as bad as the United States. But we don't know what the future has got in store for us because of the big slum area, because of the choice, particularly in the cities. So I don't really think that there is a lot of thinking that is going to happen publicly. I'm sure they are discussing internally as to how to handle it. Partly it will depend upon when the virus comes in control in the Indian context, and then they will decide. But they will definitely have some requirements immediately. There will be the whole question of people below the poverty line who have suffered, and there will be some kind of support that will have to be given to them. I think one support they are giving is that many of these green zones will probably open next month. Maybe even as early as 3rd of May, we don't know. But that's a possibility. Now, green zones is really half of India. It's mostly the rural India. And so rural India may slowly start limping back. I won't say it will leap back, but it may limp back. Because there will not be interstate transport for sure. So even if they grow or even if they produce something, what will they do with their production? But there may be some local activity that will take place. But how much of the budgetary resources the government will shift from long-term infrastructure to immediate crisis resolution, it's very difficult to say. I mean, we all know to some extent it will happen, but exactly to what extent, it's very difficult to say. It will depend on how long the problems go on.
Right. So, another aspect is this talk is happening now, you know, whether it's true or not, whether it's just a talk, that now markets world over will see, or they're trying to see a shift from China, and they have whatever anti-China sentiments they have, or those emotions are high. So they would see India as an opportunity to source their requirement from. So how much of this is true? And if it's true, then where we are in this scenario?
Well, I think India should develop its capacity for exports and to become a resource for the world, irrespective of anything that's happening outside, irrespective of international politics, irrespective of what is happening in China or Korea or US or here or there. I think the critical thing is that India has to be export worthy. And at the end of the day, any businessman will tell you that there has to be a business case. There cannot be just a political case. There has to be a business case. So if the businesses are going to invest in India, if they are going to procure goods from India, there will have to be a business case. There will have to be they must be satisfied in terms of the quality, in terms of the competitive prices, and that is what will eventually decide. I don't really think that our ability to export is any way particularly linked to any political developments.
Okay. So this, even if we say that there's a shift from of the world market to India, where do you think we are in terms of our capability, capacity side as of now? Would we be able to justify the shift which will happen to whatever extent from China to India? Are we ready?
I'm not sure. That the political talk about shift will get translated into a business case. I don't know. I'm not sure. Because politics is one and a business case is another. At the end of the day, the businesses will be driven by the business case. They will not be dependent on the political rhetoric. What is happening right now about a shift is a political rhetoric. We have to seek what happens in terms of business case. I don't know what is the business case of this entire political rhetoric. I don't even know if this political rhetoric will continue beyond November. Because a lot of it is coming from the US, and a lot of it is directly linked to President Trump's election. And President Trump wants an enemy so that he can win the election. The way his politics is, he needs an enemy. So last time he had thought of Islamist terrorist groups as the enemy. This time he has identified China as the enemy. So he needs an enemy. So once his purpose is served, whether he wins or loses the elections, I don't know to what extent this rhetoric will go on. Like, for example, what happened last time? Last time, till the election day, he talked about the terrorism coming from the Middle East and from the Arab countries. And after he became the first, became the president, his first visit was to Saudi Arabia. His very first visit was to Saudi Arabia to do a defense deal. And he did a deal worth billions of dollars with Arab countries. And at that time, Saudi Arabia was having a conflict with Qatar, and Qatar complained that the US was selling arms to Saudi Arabia. So he said, okay, Qatar, we supply to you also. So then he supplied. So his entire election campaign was about the countries that were in the Middle East that were supporting terrorism. And his first visit was to Saudi Arabia and to do deals worth billions of dollars. Now he's talking about China, and I don't know if in March his first visit is to China to try to do a business deal with them. I don't know. I mean, I'm not saying he will do that, but his behavior after the last election showed that he does exactly what suits his business interest. So therefore, I would not personally be influenced by the political rhetoric which is really originating in the US.
So, taking that point further of yours, now this is what will happen on the political scenario. Nobody has any answer for that, how things will shape up. From the business scenario in India, as entrepreneurs, now a lot of business has, it is said that it's going to Vietnam now from China. And so are we not ready as entrepreneurs, or what should we do? As maybe a few quick points if you have in mind.
No. See, my entire point is that India should be export worthy anyway. Right. Let's not let's not worry about what's happening in politics.
Mm-hmm.
Why are we giving too much importance to what is happening in politics and the political rhetoric? Mm-hmm. The businessman must focus on how to get the maximum advantage through a business case.
Mm-hmm.
And basically, if you have a business case, you would be like, see, the vaccine industry has created a business case, and mm-hmm. they're now set to become multi-billion-dollar giants. Mm-hmm. So in any industry, you have to see an opportunity and you have to make a business case as to how you would be able to identify the gaps and move in very quickly. Now, to what extent we are already ready, which will depend on sector to sector, and I really wouldn't have an idea of the situation at the ground level. But my point is that we should increase our capacity to operate in the world market irrespective of these political developments. Why are we even thinking of these political developments?
True.
These political developments will happen, they will change, and we will be left high and dry. I don't think we have to be guided by that. We have to see how we can take advantage. Now, see, there is one problem that we might face, and we have to see how to overcome that problem. That if the lockdown in India continues for a long time, if it continues, I don't know how long will it continue in the cities. I'm not talking about the villages, but in major cities like Mumbai, Pune, Delhi, Calcutta, Hyderabad, particularly Bangalore, then we might lose some of the business which is coming to India in the form of back offices or business process outsourcing. Because many of the multinational companies may not like people working from home. And, for example, processing of banks, processing of financial institutions, they may not like a lot of it being processed out of homes of individuals. They may not like individual staff to take financial papers home or take important documents home or take letterheads home. And so they may just shift to closer to their own countries.
Mm.
So in that case, what is the alternative are you able to provide if this lockdown goes on for a long time? So instead of finding new opportunities, there is a new threat that might come our way. And we have to see if somebody can take advantage of that and see what is the alternative that you are able to provide. So basically, I don't think there is any generic answer. This is a question that's being discussed a lot as to how India can move ahead. But this is discussed in a very generic way. We have to see for each sector, what are the opportunities that you can create and how you can create a business case on the ground, both for attracting investments and for creating export capacity at a time when the market is going to shrink. So when the world market is going to shrink, what is that they are going to need? For example, they will need food. I was saying yesterday that, today, sometime back, that, and I've been saying all the time to everybody, that there could be severe disturbances in the food market, in the food grains and fruits, vegetables, processed foods. So there is a huge business opportunity there that... in the next 1 year, it may not last for very long, but in the next 1 year, there is a lot of export that can be done in terms of fruits, vegetables, food grains, and processed foods. So there is a huge opportunity there. And it's because of the crisis. Because in a lot of places, the food production is going to decline. So then you have to identify where the gaps could be and where you could export. So there could be a big opportunity there. So really, it is sector by sector you have to find out. There will be some sectors which will suffer. But it's only the people who are on the ground, they would know. I don't think this generic talk about whether India is prepared, what should India do, I don't think this is helpful at all. I've been hearing a lot of it. But this is because there is nothing like, India is not one monolithic. India is a very vibrant democracy. We should be proud of that. And it's not only democracy in a political sense, but it's also democracy in economic sense. And we have a huge diversified industry. We have a huge diversified service sector. We have a huge diversified primary sector. And so we can't really have one solution for the entire economy. We have to see in each sector and subsector what the opportunities are. And then accordingly take advantage of the situation.
बहुत बढ़िया. आई थिंक दैट्स व्हाट यू इफ यू हैव टू सम अप व्हाट यू सेड इज दैट इट्स टाइम दैट ईच वन ऑफ अस गोज इनटू आवर ओन सेक्टर एंड वी गो डीप इनटू इट अंडरस्टैंडिंग द फ्यूचर ऑफ दिस सेक्टर. At the same time, we should also put a lot of energy, effort into studying what sectors will move.
Exactly.
So overall, let's not make it general. We have to go deeper into it. And I think we have to put a thinking hat on right
exactly.
now. Each
exactly.
One of us.
Exactly.
Sir, taking this forward, see, a lot of laborers have moved back to their villages and their towns. Now, what is going to be the impact of these laborers going back? Will the towns emerge as the centers there, or will they come back at a very higher salaries, or will they not come back, or their families will not allow them to come back? How do you think things will shape?
No, I think if the pandemic is contained, they will come back.
Okay.
In a few months' time.
Uh-huh.
There is simply no alternative. I mean, what will they do in the villages? Mm-hmm. Unless there is an opportunity for them to grow, they don't want to go there and starve. Right now, they are gone there because the alternative is worse. That they are afraid of contracting the disease in the cities. They are unhappy with the living conditions in the cities. And it's a general sense of insecurity psychologically. You want to be close to your family. So that is why they are gone. But at some stage, they will face the economic realities. And I think that's why I said in a year's time, in a year and a half, things will start getting back to normal. And with these workers, if the pandemic is in control, in a 6 months' time, they will start coming back to wherever they find opportunity. Maybe somebody who had gone to Rajasthan may not go back to Rajasthan. He might find new opportunities in Mumbai or in Madhya Pradesh or in Tamil Nadu. They might go there. But they can't live in those villages without any jobs. Unless there is a big growth of the agriculture sector. Mm-hmm. Unless our investors go there and find that, you know, you can start supplying to the whole world and they start producing there. If you do that, then some people will get employment, but that also is limited. In the end, they will come back. I don't think it will be a problem in a few months' time.
Okay. And there's a question on the leadership side. What do you feel about the leadership? One question was there. What do you think about the leadership of India? Are we in good hands? And I don't know whether we should go into it or not. Your choice, sir. I leave it up to you.
No, I don't want to make any political comment.
Okay. Right.
And I don't think it's relevant at all. My belief is that at a time when the country is in crisis, whoever is the leader, we have to be completely with the leader. And
absolutely,
we have to be together as a country. And we have to see how we can counter the crisis in a united way and in a sensible way. I don't think we should be even evaluating the questions of leadership. This is not a time in the middle of the crisis. In the middle of the crisis, somebody has to take leadership. We have a democratic process whereby we have a leader and we have a cabinet. And we have to simply follow the instructions. We have to trust our democratic process. We have to follow. We may not be happy with every decision they may take. But then the government has to take a decision considering many different factors. They are not there only to consider our situation. They are there to consider the situation of the whole country and of different constituencies. So I would say that this is not the time to think about politics. I said earlier in a different context that even when we think about international market, it's not a time to think about politics. It's the time to see how to create opportunities irrespective of the political rhetoric of China and US and all that. Similarly, I think within the country, we just have to see how we can bring our country out of this crisis, how we go back to normal period as soon as possible, and how we do whatever is required of us to be done on the medical advice. I think that's what we should do.
I think that's fantastic thought process from your side, that let's be behind the leadership, and they have bigger things and they have a bigger vision of what they're doing, and we might be just a small part of it. So we should not judge them from what is happening to us and what we're going through. And it is so important that people understand this point, sir. And other than that, the other point was, which is very powerful, is the thought process that we should be ready for the export side. We should be ready for the best. Let's not wait for something to happen to us and then we decide of going into exports and we decide of improving ourselves. That should be a constant quest in us, that we become world ready or we become world relevant. Right? We have a startup question here, and says any insight on the startup side, how challenging it's going to be for startups which are already cash strapped, or they're having already the financial challenge. So now in this scenario, what would you suggest for the startups?
You know, startups are always in a difficulty. It's nothing to do with coronavirus. I mean, have you ever heard of a startup which doesn't have challenges? But that is the very, very meaning of startup, that you are starting up. And so starting up means, see, you are, so up means if you are sitting, and when you stand up, it involves a lot of effort. So similarly, when you are starting and you try to go up, it involves a lot of effort. So let's not think that this is going to create some extraordinary situation. They're always in a difficulty. There is always a cash crunch for startup. They always have to prove themselves. There is no doubt about that. But I think what we really need to think, and this again depends on which sector you are operating in, is really to see how to find opportunities. I'll give you an example of Infosys. Infosys and all these export software export companies in the 1980s were doing really badly. I mean, in 1980s, the founder of Infosys, Narayan Murthy, couldn't even get loan from HDFC to buy a two-bedroom house in Mumbai. And that was in the 1980s. And he had a lot of difficulty to convince them. Okay. And similarly with many other companies, they were all struggling because they were all startups. But in 92-93, they saw that this Y2K problem would come up in the world. And they all worked on this Y2K. And this ingenuity of the Indian software companies at that time to work on the Y2K problem at the low cost and to be supplier to the whole world. So that is how they all became giants. And by 93, 94, 95, all these companies which you had never heard of before, they became multinationals really. And they became with having net worth of thousands of crores. So what they did, that in the middle of the whole problem of Y2K, they found an opportunity for themselves. So I think this is what our entrepreneurs need to learn, that instead of worrying about the problem that the whole world is facing, you have to see in that problem, what is your opportunity? That's what the Indian software exporters did. And so all of them, I mean, even TCS was not as big a giant as it is now in the 1980s. So all of them under Kohli's leadership, Mr. F.C. Kohli's leadership at that time, Mr. Narayan Murthy's leadership in Infosys, Azim Premji, see, all these people, they saw, oh, here is a problem that the world is going to face, but I'm going to be the solution for this problem. And they all got into it in a significant way. And they became rich and they became successful. So you have to see, now there is a problem that the world is facing. Now this vaccine people, they have nicely thought, now this is where they can not only succeed for themselves, but they can also solve a big problem for humanity. And they can help the common people and the people who are affected and infected to come out of this crisis. But also in the process, they will develop a good business model and they will be successful as entities. So it's really for every, whether it's a startup company or whether it's an established company, to see that in the whole problem, what is your opportunity? Now, if I had been talking to the software sector in the 80s, I would not have been able to tell them about the Y2K problem. I don't think any consultant, whether it is a big multinational consulting company from outside or whether it was a local consultant, none of them, no outsider would have been able to tell them about the Y2K. It's only the people who were inside the sector. They could see this Y2K. And they could figure out, now they have to do recoding on a massive scale. So same way, if I meet one of your colleagues who's in engineering, I won't be able to tell him anything because I know nothing about engineering. But he would know, I mean, not general engineering, the specific aspect of engineering, branch of engineering, but he would know where the problem is and where he can intervene. So that's what you have to see, that in this, take the Y2K example of our software company and see that in this scene where there are a lot of problems and people are talking about problems, what is that I'm going to provide as a solution? And not everybody will be able to do that, but the one who provides will become the Infosys of tomorrow.
I think this is such a wonderful insight, sir, that this has been said in the entrepreneurial world for many years, that be a solution provider, look at the problem and provide a solution. But I think now it is all the more relevant that we all look at our businesses as solution providers, not just providing a product or a service, but it is actually solving some problem. It is solving some need there. And this corona thing has actually maybe given us a lot of things to think about. Like, for example, you said that in the villages, if somebody can think about using the agro industry as the thought process and build something there. Right?
Absolutely.
So we got to just map out things and see where all we can fit and open the horizon. I feel that a lot of us are busy into protecting our businesses, sir. We're not thinking of doing something beyond that. We're just saying, how can I protect my business? And the thought is not going beyond that.
Exactly.
So if you can see with a flat ground that there is something else which we can build. Rather than protecting, can we build something?
I think exactly.
Your thoughts are actually leading us to the direction that can we build something different what we had not thought of before. So
see, when I think I gave this example when I visited you in Pune several months ago. I don't remember. But when Bill Gates took his first loan, first ever loan for his business, he spent 80% on strategy and marketing and 20% on production. Now, I don't think the Indian entrepreneurs are taking loans to spend 80% on strategy and marketing. I don't know, but to the extent I know the Indian businesses, I don't think they are taking loans to spend 80% on strategy and marketing and 20% on production. They are taking loans to spend 80% on production and maybe even more, maybe 100% on production. So, you know, you have to turn it around. You have to see what is your priority. If you don't have a strategy and if you don't have a market, what's the use of what you're producing? So you really have to be thinking the other way around. And I think that is what is required.
There's a question here, sir, in terms of the current scenario, the business is now being at a standstill. Now, should we go with a conservative look at our business and should we protect our capital? Or should we still be that risk-taking entrepreneur and look out? So,
It depends upon where you stand. I mean, if you have a huge debt, then of course you have to be very careful with what you do. You can't afford to take more credit, and it may not even be available to start taking risk and start getting into new ventures. But if you are in a somewhat comfortable position, then I would always say that protect what you have, but also open your mind to the new opportunities. In the kind of changes that will take place in the course of next 1 year. Now, there is another aspect that I think in 2 years' time, if this problem is contained in 2 months, then in 2 years' time, slowly the world will come back to normal. But there will be disturbances for 2 years. And these disturbances will create threats for businesses. And they will create some unusual opportunities which only the visionaries will be able to spot. So we have to decide as each entrepreneur that what is my strategy for next 2 years and what is my strategy beyond 2 years. So you have to think in two steps, because what you think for the next 2 years is not necessarily going to apply to the period beyond 2 years, because that will be more like what you were doing 2 years ago. So you really have to think in two steps, the strategy for the immediate future for the next 1 year, 2 years, and one beyond. There may be a situation where it might make a sense to lie low for some time, say for a year. Don't get into any kind of adventurism. Just lie low, just protect what you have and keep it, improve the quality of what you have. And weather the storm, as they say in English, that this is the storm that will pass away and you just kind of just keep quiet. Don't try to fool around too much. Just consolidate what you have. And once you see the storm is going away, that means after the vaccine comes and after the problem goes away, then you go out in the sea and then you see what you can do. So that's a strategy that may apply to some people. But if you spot an opportunity in this storm, then why not go and take it? So, I mean, the Infosys and other companies, they did find an opportunity in Y2K. It's exactly when there was a risk of the entire software sector collapsing. That's when they found the opportunity. So it depends on where you are positioned and, you know, what makes sense for you individually. There is another aspect that's very important to keep in mind. A lot of people are treating this whole coronavirus crisis as if this is the first crisis and this is the last crisis. You know, they think that once whatever way this is resolved, then either we will have a new kind of a economic environment, or we may go back to old economic environment, whatever. But it will be kind of a different beginning. But what if you are hit by another crisis in a year's time?
True.
You must keep that in mind. This is not a last crisis that we will face. So here there are two things to keep in mind, that there will be crisis. This is not the last crisis. There will be. There may not be pandemics. It could be something else. It could be also pandemics. It could be also not coronavirus, but some other virus. It could be more deadly than the coronavirus, or it could be less deadly than coronavirus. I mean, mind you, in the last 20 years, we had SARS, we had swine flu, we had bird flu. We had a lot of things in the last 20 years. Now, this is the first one which has gone out of hand and which is moving from country to country at a very fast pace. But it's not like this is the first virus. True. Just in a matter of last 20 years. So people are just thinking like this is the first virus attack. And they think this is the last attack. And once this is over, then whatever damage takes place, whatever it is, then we will we must think what to do beyond this. But this is crazy. You have to think and be prepared for another crisis that could take place. Now, this new crisis could be through a new virus, or may not be virus, could be something else totally different. Like in 2008, we had financial crisis. So there could be breakdown of the financial systems. That could happen. There could be environmental crisis. Say, for example, when there was a fire in Australia, those forests were set on fire in October. There was a huge fire. And the smoke went all the way to Brazil and Argentina. And they had big problems. They had not anticipated this. It took just for a few days for that smoke to travel. And that is not in anybody's control. That smoke doesn't carry a passport from the Australian government. And it doesn't require a visa from the Brazilian government. What happens tomorrow if there is a huge fire in Bangladesh and we have a smoke coming all the way here? So you could have, and it leads to major pollution. So you could have any kind of problem. You could have a major conflict between the two big powers, whether it's US, Russia, China, whatever. And there could be a threat of the use of nuclear weapons. And if that happens, even on a small scale, if that happens, you could have the worst crisis that you could ever... I have to drink water one second.
Yeah, please, please.
You could have the worst crisis that you can imagine. So, I think people are making a big mistake by thinking that this is the last crisis. So, if you are in your 30s or 40s, for a lot of young entrepreneurs, or even 50s, you've got another 20 to 40 years to go. And you're going to face many, many, many crises. I'm not talking about business problems. I'm talking about all these other issues. Even now, if some big US businesses go bankrupt next year because of the falling demand and for other reasons, that could lead to the collapse of banks. Now, US Federal Reserve is already pumping in money in the banks. They can foresee this happening. And so generally, the economists are saying that this will not be a contagion, that our banks don't have to worry and things will be okay. But you don't know. So basically, we have to be prepared for different kind of crisis. I think one thing that if I were a businessman, I would learn a lesson from this is to always build reserves and keep for a rainy day. Because you don't know what kind of crisis will come. Unlike before, when the world was not so integrated, the crisis could be manageable. They could be local, they could be small. But now the crises are global of all kinds, whether it's environmental crisis, whether it's crisis related to war, whether it is a crisis related to another pandemic, whether it's crisis related to the economic system. So I think the one lesson that we should all draw who are in business is to build reserves. That you must have some reserves for those crises which could take place anytime. Mm-hmm. We sometimes have a tendency to overinvest. Mm-hmm. But I think it's very important to build a reserves.
Right. With this, sir, if you were to see now, there are two things which have emerged. We are running. We'll take around 10 minutes, sir. Maybe 10 minutes.
Yeah.
This thought process of now that life will become all the more uncertain in terms of what things will happen. So this is not the first and last virus. And things will happen. Virus can be in any form, financial virus or any, like you said.
Right.
Now with this, now we are left with this thought process that should we plan for 2 years when we don't know what will happen in these 2 years? Will it still make sense? For example, nobody thought this will happen in terms of today's situation. So we had planned a year back, and then all those things we had planned went for a toss. For example, the travel industry right now, if you were to see, the travel industry has been hit badly. So they had not envisaged, they had not thought that something of this would happen. And so should we still plan for long term, or should we still keep small plans and move on?
No. I think right now, immediately, because one thing is certain, that next 2 years are uncertain. So this uncertainty itself is a certainty. That is for sure. So I think we have to see how we will sail through this uncertainty. And then, you have to assume that there will be normal times, you have to plan. And if something happens, you have to deal with it. That is what happened to the travel industry. I mean, within travel industry, you take a small niche, which is the conference industry. There are a huge number of conferences take place, and it's become a multi-billion dollar industry. That the entire industry has collapsed. At least travel industry will come back, because there will be people traveling for other reasons. Personal reasons, business reasons, tourism. Slowly it will pick up. But the conference industry will find it very difficult to pull the threads again, because people will be worried about being in a meeting place where 1,000 people are together. At least for a year or two, people will be really, really worried. I mean, till the virus is completely, completely eliminated. So, you have to see how you can plan in the next 2 years. But we have to, assume the normal and work accordingly, because that way a lot of things can happen. Personally, an accident can take place. There may be no virus in the whole world, but personally somebody can affected with a serious health issue. And if you are an entrepreneur and 200 people depend on you, but if you are the center, and if everything depends on you, and if you fall sick seriously with a cancer or something, the whole system is going to collapse. So even if there is no virus in the whole world, as far as you are concerned, the world is collapsing. So these things you can't really predict. I mean, an earthquake can take place. How do you know? The earthquake took place in Nepal, and entire Nepal was finished. Every industry, every segment of economy was finished. So you can't plan for every emergency. I would say to plan not for every emergency, but plan for any emergency. So what you do for considering there could be any emergency, you have to have some reserves kept. You have to have a very innovative mindset. So you know that if something happens, how do you move from one sector to another? Or how do you create opportunities for yourself? So I think that is what you'll have to do. You have to have new kind of attitude. That's what is a new kind of glasses you have to wear to look at the world. But you can't prepare for, another virus, what I'm going to do, some fires, what I'm going to do. Of course, you can't prepare for that. No. Environmental crisis, I think that's one sector that you'll have to watch very closely. Mm-hmm. Because environmental and climatic crisis, especially if you're looking at next 20-year plan, this is going to be one big issue. And you have to see what will be the consequences of that.
Mm-hmm. You have been doing a deep study on the environment, and especially the water side. So the kind of impact it would have on for us as normal people, we have no idea as to what kind of impact it can have on us as individuals or as businesses. But on the global scenario, if things go further south in terms of the environment, what do you think will be the impact on the industry or on normal life?
No, it will be quite bad in every respect. Mm-hmm. Could be a disaster. That again, we'll have a lot of specific. There is nothing like a global environmental impact. In some cases, there will be water shortage. Mm. In some cases, there will be sea level rise. Mm. So in the US, for instance, there is one national park. And it was set up 100 years ago. And at that time, there were 150 glaciers. It was set up just 100 years ago. And already 120 glaciers have disappeared. And the remaining 30 glaciers they think will disappear in the next 30 years. So in a matter of 100 years, you know, every day you go and see, you don't see the difference. But you take a stock after 20 years, 30 years, you see the difference. So similarly in India, if some sources of water dry out, if there is a shift in the cropping patterns, of course, with the environmental crisis, agriculture will be first affected. But there will be implications for other industries also in a very significant way. Some of the coastal cities could be affected eventually, further down the line. There could be a lot of other things. I mean, environmental crisis could lead to disasters, and that could have a big problem. One thing is that today nobody is safe and nobody can be sure. I mean, Australia had fires and Brazil got affected. China had coronavirus and 150 countries got 100 to 180 countries got affected. US has financial meltdown, and again 50 countries will be affected. So today everything is integrated, and you can predict what's happening in your city or in your village or in your state, but you can't predict what is happening in the another part of the world. That's just not possible. So you have to keep your eyes and ears open. You have to look for signals all the time. And you have to see what the signals mean for you in every respect. I mentioned at the beginning that WHO had issued the warning of global health emergency on 30th of January, and nobody took it seriously. But now at least we have to see if these organizations like WHO, then IPCC, which deals with climate change, FAO, World Food Program, these major organizations, are they issuing any warnings? And then see what it means for me. And I think that is how we will have to conduct ourselves.
Great. So if I were to sum up the last part of your talk, sir, it is one is that we have to keep reserves in terms of will not be spendthrifts, have to have some reserves. Second is to have mental agility, which you rightly said that we should be able to shift. And third, the understanding that we are not living in isolation. Something happens in some part of the world, it's going to have an effect on us in any aspect, in every aspect. So this is the very, very insightful part of it. Last question, and this has been doing the round in my chat box here. A lot of people are from the construction industry here. So what is your understanding of the housing segment in the country? Will it pick it up?
I just don't know the field. I just don't know the sector. I can't comment on every sector.
I know that. But there's so many people are there.
I simply don't know the sector. I think the people in the sector know their sector better than...
They better should know.
anybody outside. I should ask them what's going to happen in the construction industry. But one thing is that I don't know so much about housing construction, but the investments are going to be slow in the industrial construction. So those who are in the business of, you know, building factories and warehouses and... warehouses may be okay, but factories and plants and all that, there may be a clear problem for a year or so. And of course, all of that will have impact on housing. But construction industry was affected, you know, for last 1 year or 2 years. So let's not, you know, blame everything on coronavirus. And let's not say because of coronavirus, construction industry is going to have problem. Construction industry is having problem for last 2 years. They know pretty well. And the housing market has been stagnant for last 3-4 years. So let's not try to put everything on this current crisis. But I think I have to go in.
Yes, sir.
Or two.
I think it was very insightful, sir, and thank you so much for taking our time for all of us one more time. And I'll send you the feedbacks which we have got from all the entrepreneurs there. And you could put some thought on all the questions which were there. And I did try to move around with the questions, but thank you so much for your insights. And keep on doing the good work which you're doing, sir. The kind of work and the kind of positivity you spread down. The entire talk which you had, I think every time there was an idea of positivity. Never I found any kind of feeling that there is negativity or there is a thought of you feeling low about the whole situation. You are upbeat about everything. And I think that is such a wonderful thing for all of us to understand and take back home, that there is so many opportunities around us. And every setback comes with its own bag of opportunities. The question is, where are we looking? And that's what you said to all of us.
But we have to be realistic also at the same time. You have to be upbeat in a realistic way, not in a... Not in an illusory way, but in a realistic way. So good luck to all your colleagues who are sitting there.
Thank you so much, sir.
To every single person. I think you have built a good network. Entrepreneurship development is really what is needed And what I really like about you is you are telling them not only to look after business, but also to take a more holistic view, the 360 view. I think that's really important. And I encourage you to do that. I think it's a big problem with our businessmen is they only look at the balance sheet. And I think that is why they are failing. Those who fail, they fail because of that. They really have to learn to take a much more comprehensive 360 view in their business and outside the business. And what I said in the beginning, that they have to start thinking strategically. Right. Then what strategy will come later? But first, they must admit they have to think strategically.
Right.
So I wish them good luck, and I wish you good luck, and we'll be in touch. Okay.
Thank you so much. Bye. Thank you so much. Namaste, sir. Thank you. Thank you so much. I feel that whatever he had time for, I think he gave so many insights. And I wanted to write those insights and share with us. So many questions aap logon ke the on different industries. Koi auto ke bare mein pooch raha tha, koi startup ke bare mein pooch raha tha, koi travel ke bare mein pooch raha tha. See, I felt that he's not a master of all those industries. He's not a master to know everything about every business, but he had a fair amount of idea that as entrepreneurs, abhi samay aa gaya ki hum log jo hai ek thinking hat pehne, hum log apne areas ke andar ghuse, dekhen ki kya ye area hai, kya ye develop hoga aage jaake, aur baki aur kya naya aane wala hai, hame wo bhi dekhna chahiye. So right from protecting what you have, but also at the same time see what you can build new in your life. And बहुत से मौके होंगे जिसको हम लोगों ने सोचना चाहिए समझना चाहिए but play safe you got to preserve what you have and take care of some comfort level of yours during tough times and then look out for opportunities and if you have some spare something extra then you can utilize that as you go on so those of you who are not part of CF or those who have I would suggest that you be a part of CF membership is there I have called a lot of entrepreneurs from my previous batches so please I called you because you should know what's happening on the CF on the Chrysalis Entrepreneur Forum front. So maximize this time which we have in hand and wish you all the very best that we all grow, we all sustain. I was there, just to share with you, I was in a webinar and I was asked this question that what is your understanding of having a winning mindset? So I told them that winning mindset ko na abhi aapko definition badalni padegi. So winning is not about reaching to your goals. Winning is not about becoming better than what you are. Right now in this scenario, winning is all about holding what you have. So, जो आपके पास है अगर आपने उसी को बचा के रख लिया, that is a win. आपके पास जो आपकी टीम है आपने उसमें से अच्छे लोगों को बचा के रख लिया, that's a win. आपके पास जो कस्टमर्स हैं आपने अपने कस्टमर्स को बचा के रख लिया, that's a win. आपका अपना टर्नओवर है आपने वो टर्नओवर भी करके रख लिया, that's a win. आपने अपने मार्जिन को मेंटेन करके रख लिया वो that's a win. आपने मार्जिन को नहीं मेंटेन किया लेकिन फिर भी सेल लेके आ गए, that's a win. आपने प्रॉफिट नहीं भी कमाया लेकिन कस्टमर को होल्ड करके रख लिया, that's a win. So, अपनी विनिंग की डेफिनेशन बदलिए ये मुश्किल समय है लेकिन यही तो समय है जहां पर हम एज एंटरप्रेन्योर्स एज लीडर्स हम अपना लोहा बता सकते हैं कि व्हाट स्टफ वी आर मेड अप ऑफ एंड आई फील लेट्स यूटिलाइज दिस इन द बेस्ट पॉसिबल वे व्हाट स्टफ वी आर मेड अप ऑफ एंड आई एम श्योर ये सिचुएशन भी टलेगी जो मेरी स्टोरी है आप लोगों को मालूम है दिस टू शैल पास तो हम इससे भी बाहर निकलेंगे और हम आगे बढ़ेंगे सो ऑल द बेस्ट टू ऑल ऑफ यू And make the most of what life has given to us. You can't fight with life. You can align yourself with life. So let's align with this phase and make the best